croissant.
Where do I go?
Follow me.
Dear grandson, my prophet, my tattooed poet of the sweetheart, the wounds your father gave you, God did not heal, but did close, even if in scars, so that you received this strength to stand up against him for yourself. To declare just as a boy your independence, and to determine to grow into your own man. This is one of your gifts and wonders that makes me admire you, makes me happiest about you, for you. I ask you, in dead seriousness, think about what being a man is. The strength of heart to fight for love, to defend it over and over and over again. That's manly.
I love you too.
Anyway, it'll be wonderful to see you. I much look forward to it. Love, your Grandpa Packack.
We'll just spray out through, clip it right there.
Yeah.
Bada bing, bada boom. Let's do it through my jacket.
Oh, God.
What I could do maybe? Nah, I'll do it on the jacket, yeah.
You want me to?
Yeah.
Bro, you're so professional, bro.
Yeah, no, it's just crazy.
You have all the gear, everything, like, it's nice.
Alright, could I get you to just say something quick?
Yeah, I was just picking my nose. I hope you weren't recording.
How long you guys been working on music?
Shit. I've been working on music like 7 months now, bro. I'm all over the place right now. Like, I'm gonna be staying here, I'm gonna be staying in LA, you know what I'm saying? I just fuck with my friends, yo.
It's just some family shit, bro.
Yeah, it's just some family shit. Nothing other than that, bro.
You know how to touch gently. I've seen you do.
I touch gently.
A very good gentle touch. All done eating? Tookty. I bet that was good. Let's just take a little spongy.
Like that?
Yeah. The night that he was born, he opened his eyes and looked me right in the eye. In a way that I hadn't was completely surprised by, great big brown eyes, and he looked at me like, okay, so introductions, let's go. And I said, hi, I'm your mama and I love you. I was like, I'll never forget that moment. And he was like a little tiny the little characters in Snow White. They're like little Walt Disney characters with these big eyes. So he was just like a little peep.
I'm gonna do this. I'm gonna do the dad to talking.
Well, you're talking now. I can hear you. I can hear you in the camera. That's called a microphone. You don't want to grab it.
I wanna do the microphone.
Gus had a way about him when he would walk into the class. He always had a smile. Always had a smile. And the first thing he would say is, good morning, Mrs. Camacho. You know, one thing that got me was his creativity. He was a very creative artist and writer. And I picked up on that very quickly.
You can do it.
I can't do it.
Yeah, you can do it.
I can't do it.
Oh, come on, you can do it.
No.
Yeah, come on, you can do it.
You can do it. There, no. I'm done.
Okay, you're feeling a little shy, aren't you? I can tell there's mischief in your eyes, and yet...
But if you meet me in real life, you'll find out that I'm not very confident, and I'm a very sensitive person, and I have a lot of insecurities.
It wasn't just like, I'm writing catchy songs. I feel like Gus talked about the pain too, and a lot of people were drawn to it because he's brutally honest about it.
I remember we'd like go out and he had all these tattoos, and he's always like, don't you feel weird like walking into a restaurant with me? And I'd be like, why do you get all these tattoos if you care so much about it? Like, if you're going to be so insecure about it, why did you do that? Because he was like, he knew people were judging him and it did upset him.
I used to bike everywhere. Like, where I grew up in New York was a really small surfing community, so everyone just biked everywhere. Like, they actually made it, like, I remember the year I moved, they made it illegal to be drunk on a bike. Like, you can get pulled over.
It's a DUI, yeah.
Yeah.
And I'm also a professional handlebar rider. I can hop on someone's handlebars if they're going like 30 miles an hour. They're like, whoo!
Honestly, a huge reason he did it was he was like, I'm not gonna have like a normal job. I don't ever want a normal job, and I'm going to make myself not be this like normal person.
Being a normal kid in Long Beach is you're going to the beach all the time. You want to be a lifeguard because that's the coolest thing you can be in middle school or high school, is that you're a lifeguard and you're playing lacrosse and you're playing beach volleyball. And it's very much a small beach town. In Long Beach, it's almost like a tribalism of we're from Long Beach. And like we do things our way, and everyone else is trash.
Gus, from the beginning, was a creative and different kid. Big, like pink and green Osirises on that like went up to his knees. So he stood out just from the start. Probably had a mohawk at the time too. He communicated through his image, and like you could tell that he was different from the rest of us.
It tickles. My lips.
You stuck in a closet and I'll get out.
I remember in 10th grade when we were dating, he didn't answer me for 2 hours. And I was like, what the hell are you doing? And he was like, my parents are getting divorced. And the day after, he like broke up with me and we didn't speak for a really long time. And after that, like, he was like completely a different person. Like he started hanging out with different people. He came to school less, stopped going to his classes.
He used to talk to me about how much he hated high school, and he'd throw up in the morning sometimes before he had to go.
They were all judging him. You know, well, you're not an athlete, and you're smoking pot, and you're getting tattoos, and you're not applying to college, and I don't want you going over to Gus's house anymore. You know, there were several parents who made, he told me that, and he told that to me, and he cried. He just felt like an absolute loser. I was worried about him, yeah, for quite a while, because he was in his bedroom, and he had to have black curtains, so it was all dark in there, and it just seemed so grim. He was in there a lot and sad. He was in there a lot and sad.
965.
Like, I would hang out with Gus when he didn't want to think about that type of shit. You know what I mean? Like, he was always like really good at like hiding like any feelings that he had or anything like that. He was good at it. So like, it was hard. It's hard to tell like whether or not he was like bothered. You know what I mean? It always was.
He would run away. Like, we would just dip from the school, and that's when he would just like record most of the early on stuff.
You've been blessed.
I remember laying in his bed, and his name was Trap Goose at the time, and he was like, I think I'm gonna change my name to Lil Peep. And I was like, why? And he's like, my mom calls me Peep. And I was like, I think that's kind of weird. Like, it sounds like Lil Penis. And I made fun of him for it. And he was like, no, I'm doing it, I don't care.
Diddy Bo's on the track, boy.
Me personally, like, I thought, like, if you wanted to be a rapper, you were a fucking idiot. Like, come on. There's just so many other things that you could be in life. Like, why do you want to be a rapper? Like, that doesn't make any sense to me. But when Gus was doing it, I obviously had that same kind of thought, like, you're a fucking idiot. Like, just do something normal. But I was still his friend, and I wasn't gonna sit there and tell him that. Like, I never told him, like, be something else, like, because I knew that he was serious about it.
He didn't want to go see anybody he knew. And in our town, you go anywhere, you know somebody, they're gonna say, oh, what are you doing now? And what was he gonna say? Like, oh, making music. Like, nobody would have thought anything of it. And he would have just been like judged by it.
Basically, my father was like a surrogate father. You know, he was the guy that Gus figured, okay, my own blood father is definitely not somebody I respect, certainly, and not somebody I'm going to spend any, waste my energy on. And he, I think, kind of transferred his, you know, who was my male figure, you know, onto his grandpa.
I remember Gus literally told me once, if he was to die, he thinks Jack would be like the person welcoming into heaven. Like, he literally thought like Jack was God. He loved him so much. He was like super just intelligent, very smart, but he also like didn't judge anybody. He'd always say that. Whenever Gus like got a new tattoo or something, Jack like wouldn't even notice. Like, he just like looked him straight in the eyes always. And I think Gus like really appreciated that.
My dad is a big letter writer. He's old school. So he does like to write a lot of emails, but he also does like to write actual letters and send them in the mail. I mean, he wrote to the boys a lot and he felt that it was important to write to both of them. Gus was home, Oscar was in college, but Gus was floundering. So he just wanted to reach out to Gus and write to him.
Dear Gus, I think your mama asked you if you'd like to do that research for me at the NYU library for pay and travel and other expenses into the city and out. Let me know if you'll do it. I'm sure you can do it. Your mom and I can easily explain how. I believe in you, Gus. I know you'll find your way, and it'll be a good, strong way. These days, especially, take good care of yourself. Think about things you really like or don't like. Wonder why you like them or don't. Talk to your friends about them. Or make friends that do want to talk about him. Life is full of surprises. Some of them, I know from my experiences, are very bad, but some are wonderful. I can tell you, too, that these years you're living now, 16, 17, are particularly hard years. It's hard to know what to do, but you'll get through them, and things will start to get clear and make sense. Whatever you may say or do, have faith in yourself and in your mama. I do look forward to seeing you at some point over the summer. Love, back at your grandpa.
Wait, you don't have enough to do an interview yet?
I don't know.
Where?
Walk away. I'm telling you, it fucking looks...
She tells me she's not upset, but look at her.
We started to make the music videos because we were just like bored and wanted to get out of the house, and it was something to get Gus out of the house, because other than that, he wasn't leaving his room. It had to be like music involved. So I wanted to go to my house when we went did the Live Forever music video, and I was like, if we go to my house, I'll shoot a music video for you. He was like, fine, we could go.
Messaged him on SoundCloud and I was like, bro, you're amazing. I had a small following, like 5,000 followers. He had like 200 or some shit. But I just loved this shit. I was like, bro, let's make some music. Like, I love what you're doing. Yeah.
I remember looking at you through the window in my bedroom.
And then, yeah, he sent his clips through, like, he had the, like, the dustiest green screen. It was like a green bed sheet, and I had, like, green cardboard here. We was both, like,
yeah, we was wrong,
we didn't know what we were doing. And, like, you can see the green line around us and shit when I edited it.
It was perfect, though, now when you look back at it.
Yeah, because we were so new to it, you know?
He's trying to do this work, and Emma kind of brings him out of it, and he's making progress and getting better at it and meeting people online and doing the stuff and on his own, and probably so much of it unbeknownst to me, except for the fact that every night I heard him singing. You know, he worked while I slept, but I heard him. And so this was made me happy because he was doing something that he enjoyed and was committed to.
Eventually, he made a couple songs like Star Shopping, and I'm just like, dude, like, it's over. Like, now you got it.
I'm so fucking excited. Oh, I'm shaking.
And I've never seen him satisfied with his own music before, too. He used to be embarrassed of it. And now he's playing his songs every day, over and over.
We're right here.
Change was real, and like people were like, damn, all right, Little Peep is actually a thing.
In a schema, we had like 30 rappers. We were like Wu-Tang or like old Bruce Mafia. I only needed to hear like the first four bars a little bit. That's it. I sent Peep a DM, matter of fact. And the first thing I told him was, we're gonna blow you up. Like, I didn't say, hey, what's up? My name Green, blah, blah, blah. All I said was, we're gonna blow you up. And then later on, I think we all hopped on the phone and just was like planning shit out. How we gonna do things, and we're gonna do a tour here and yada, yada, yada. So it started like in Tucson.
It was like, I don't know, it was kind of surreal because I was like, well, I'm out here with a bunch of people that I've like met on the internet, and like we're doing this thing now. We're like playing a show together and stuff. I remember like 30 or 40 kids showed up, and the venue looked like it used to be a meth den or something, and then there was an explosion and they like gutted everything. Like it was just a total shithole, but it was awesome. And there was no stage. There was obviously a few songs of mine that went off, but like Gus played Beamer Boy because Beamer Boy like just came out at that time. And it was just everyone in that bitch was singing. Like it was so crazy.
At that point, he was real, real happy at that point, because I think from that show, he started to believe that, you know what, I can actually do this shit. You know what I'm saying? I'm in my zone now, I put my phone down,
I'm on my own now, I'm on my own. We're performing that our tracks we made.
Yeah.
But how we're gonna do it is you guys are gonna go on first, do your opening thing, and then like when we all come out, me, Jay, and Ghost, I'm gonna do them with you guys.
Oh, bet.
So it's like a segue into it.
Yeah, like you guys do your shit first, and then once we all us three come out, you know, I'm probably gonna do Beamer Boy like second. I don't know. Yeah. But my set.
I remember the table broke, everybody fell, and then I like grabbed my laptop, plugged the aux back in. They were like on the microphone. I'm like holding my shit like this, playing the music. There's no more table.
One day we were sitting outside of this pizza shop. Gus was like, how long have we been? Like, we were trying to calculate how long we've been in Denver and shit. And we all were like, yeah, that was like, the show was like 2 weeks ago, right? And we were all like, yeah, that must have been like 2 weeks ago. And then we like looked at the calendar and it had been like 2 months since the show. And then that's when we were like, fuck, we gotta like get out of here.
Holy shit!
Bro.
Wait, you didn't get it on video, did you?
What's up? What's up? What's up?
That's
lit,
dude.
Fucking
slacks.
Hey, Pete. Say what's up. And we would go to get tattooed in San Diego with Brennan. There was this guy that tattoos us there, and he's an actual cop, and he like tattoos out of his garage. Me and Pete went down to San Diego on the same day that day, and he went to his tattoo appointment because it was before mine. Me and Brennan went to the mall, and then we met up with Peep. And as we walked into the dude's house, Peep was literally like finishing up his Carberry tat. And we looked at it and we were like, dude, we did not know it was gonna be that big. And it showed me, it was like, he doesn't give a fuck. Like, he knows what he has, he knows where this is going.
I remember kind of laughing and I was like, bro, what is up with the tattoo? At the time, no other young rappers like this had face tattoos. And then he was talking about like, I swear he was like talking about like some conflict in Syria or something.
I think it was partly an identification with the press people. He, I think, really wanted to make himself an outsider.
I definitely think the planet is very sad. There's people fighting to survive, so live on for them. Well, that's why I got the crybaby tat, to keep me grateful and remind me not to be a crybaby, so I see it every time I look in the mirror, you know?
Everyone saw that he was gonna be something special, so everyone wanted to be around him, wanted to be with him, wanted to hang out with him. And not even, like, I'm not talking about leeching or anything, though there has been some of those people in his life.
I start seeing people coming over that I never even heard before. Sometimes you'll wake up, you go to the living room, you see about 10 bodies all laid out. And so you gotta get to the kitchen and you gotta step over motherfuckers like this. People you never even heard of before. Everybody just laid out. And then we like, Pete, what the fuck, who are these people? You know, and I was telling him, I'm like, why do you think you got 30 new best friends like that? He will always tell me, yo, man, yo, so-and-so said they'll pay for this for me and that for me and yada yada for me. And I was just like, it's a matter of time. It was like this. And then the next day, everybody announced they were gone. He said it wasn't for him. So he bounced. And then when he made that decision, that's when everybody followed suit. And it was over with. Scheme was over with.
This is gonna be telling you like when your good.
Dear Gus, I hear you had a pretty hard week. I'm sorry. But once you get big, and you're big now, it can get very spooky when you have a really hard fight. It's maybe hardest because even after the dust settles, it's hard to know how to reconnect, what to say, what to think, even to yourself. There are lots of people in the world, crappy as it is, whom you will learn you cannot trust. You may like them or not, you may work with them or not, but you can't trust them. If you do, they'll betray you. But there are people whom you can trust, in whom you can have faith. I know so sure that I'd put my hand in the fire to prove it. Keep your faith, and the love will always be there. Love, your Grandpa Packack.
In 2016, in the spring, Gus became homeless. And he'll call me, Mama, my phone's about to die, the card isn't working. And I say every time, are you with anybody? Because I always, moms want to know, is my son alone or does he have a friend that he's at least with? And it was always, yeah, Tracy. So there was always this Tracy who was always with him. And I thought, okay, thank goodness for Tracy. Tracy's at least sticking by my son.
We were like pretty much like glued together before any one of us had a crib, a house or anything. Like,
I used to think I loved you, now I know it ain't true, now I know it's not you, 50 on my boxes.
Everything we did was easy. It was like drinking water. It was just like another track.
Pete just automatically liked Tracy. He was like, he said to me, he brought Tracy to my house. He's like, bro, this guy's, I gotta keep him with me. You know, like he's gonna be a star.
Pete definitely found somebody that he could really fucking make music with, you know. They made White Tee within a day of knowing each other, I think, and shot the video like that same week or some shit like that. And that shit just did amazing.
He's really fast. There's never like, he's definitely not an artist that would ever like plan anything out. It's never like you would be like, yeah, like we're gonna do this, we're gonna do, like maybe like a little bit, but not really. He's very just like, let's do it now.
Do we use a smoke bird beat?
Nah, we can't.
Play it.
I really like that beat.
I love that beat. Oh, let's use that beat. It's done.
It's easy right now.
Yeah, send it to me.
Don't forget.
Yeah, send it to me right now because I tweeted it.
What's the name?
Nah, I'm just gonna write dropping within 20 minutes on. Yeah. Dropping within 20 minutes. Not 15 minutes. Fuck that, I'm only 20 minutes.
I'm gonna get into the bus, good luck, motherfucker. Back to the club, fucked up, on some my shit. All I ever wanted was a Benz and a bad.
Gus was recording anywhere he could. He didn't care what room it was, what he was doing, you know. Just. Like, they were just recording in the corner of my room. It wasn't even how I would want them to record, but it was what was most comfortable for them. And with his mix on his laptop, it didn't matter where you recorded it. Somehow it just sounded good.
I don't even know how to record myself. I just, like, turned a bunch of knobs that I didn't know what they meant. Like, I have no idea what the fuck I'm doing. People would be asking me questions, like...
So I feel like he always kind of downplayed his own, like, skills with all of that. Because like whenever I watched him do it, there was like a very calculated formula behind the way that he made his voice work on a song. And he made do with whatever he had, you know, whether it was the USB microphone or GarageBand or a $30 VHS camera that I had to shoot the video with. Like, he's just like, this is what we got. We're gonna make it work and it's gonna be perfect. It's gonna be exactly what it's supposed to be.
I'd never seen anything like it. You know what I mean? It really felt like, I was like, damn, this is like the new generation of music. I was like, all these kids are just moving out to LA and staying in Airbnbs and just like pitching in 30 bucks a day, like doing repost or whatever. I was like, it was one of the craziest things I'd ever seen before.
How many people total are there in GBC?
10.
Is it 10?
Yeah.
Okay. We all met.
It's a hard 10?
Yeah, the door's closed.
Damn, so me and Adam strong
came. I would love to join Goth Boy.
Goth Boy Click.
I just fell in love with a bad bitch. Told me that she loved me too. Baby, I'm not having it. Since the cocaine, cause I didn't have no activist.
Tracy was already in GBC and Peep wanted to be part of a group. I saw this look in Peep's eyes where he like looked up to Tracy. You know, him wanting to be in GBC stemmed from his love for Tracy.
It's almost like a brand or something, you know, so it's like, it would benefit him to have like that group of like-minded people to make music with and, you know, rep. And then he was, you know, he was already on the rise and shit, so he's like, you know, I'm gonna help you guys, bring you guys up with me, you know?
I texted Chase. I said, hey, are you listening to the radio show? You need to listen to this dude, Peep. And he goes, what's his deal? I was like, just listen. And then literally like three songs later, he goes, does he have a manager?
I meet him. And just talking with him, I'm like, you are above my head. I'm just like, dude, like, you're a star. Like, immediately I knew you're going to be huge. You know, I was asking him questions like, how do you live? Like, how are you doing this? He's just like, I don't know. I just kind of get by, whatever. So I'm like, all right, let me help you with your merch. I'm not tripping on contracts or anything. Just let me help you. You know, I'll help whatever I can, but you're going to need like a big time management company. Like, you're pop, you're a big deal.
I first heard Lil Peep on Twitter. At that point, I'd never felt like I discovered something with such passion since I was like 15 years old. It was refreshing. It was like a breath of fresh air and like a slap in my fucking face, and I showed everyone around me.
Travis came bounding into my office with some things that he'd periodically come and show me, things that he thought were cool and that he liked. He said, look at this kid. I can only describe it as an obsession. I was obsessed with this, like, 19-year-old boy. And I asked him, actually, there was at one of these early meetings, I said, how big do you want to be? How far do you want to go? I said, do you want to play stadiums? And he said, yeah, I want to play stadiums. And I said, well, I think I can help.
We lose Peep. I like call him, he doesn't answer. Sarah can't get a hold of him. Nobody knows where he is.
I had this like, it was like daily dialogue. Like, where is he? What's he doing? What do you mean you don't know? What do you mean he's not answering?
He was bouncing around a lot. He stayed there in Whittier sometimes. And shortly after that, or right around the same time, they got the loss in Skid Row, which was, I think, Ned Arp's place.
We just all came up with the money. Lederic was selling like magic cards. That's how he used to make money. Like buying and reselling magic cards and shit. So then I was a dishwasher, he was a magic card seller. And then Peep was just like, oh, I remember we were $500 away from getting this spot. So me and Peep, like, he had this song that you can find online called Mud on My Gucci or some shit like that. We sold it for like $500 and then we just used that for like the rest of the rent. And then we just split that rent like five ways, and then we were just living at the lofts together.
It was crammed with artists, Slug Christ, Tracy, me, Cortex, Peep, Nadar, Porcehead, you know, all crammed into one spot and, you know, just creating music, man, creating history.
I forget what's on the table.
You gotta like get down there.
Oh, yeah.
Exactly.
That's worth a lot of money in 1950.
That's worth like $10.
And you can't really spend that all in one place.
10 bands? Talking the tip.
All right. Just I'm going to talk into the
talk about Hellboy.
Talk about Hellboy?
Yeah, real quick.
For a brief moment.
This will drop before then.
All right, I got Kanye on there.
Mm-hmm. That's easy.
Yeah. Dude, it was like, there was a couch thing. There was like this big ass couch thing, and like three people would sleep on the couch. And then people would just pass out in chairs. Like, it was some crazy shit.
And it was, it was just like a big warehouse, basically. Like, no one had any rooms, you know. Gus's shit was all in one corner, Ned's shit was all in one corner. Tracy had all his shit, you know, in one corner. When I say debauchery, I mean debauchery, like, in the in the funnest sense of the word. Like, it was just a party. And then you go outside and it's just like Skid Row, like the purest form of Skid Row, you know, just like smells like human shit and human piss. And there's just tents everywhere.
Like, he liked living there, but it was definitely really hard for him because it was like there's just one bathroom, it's a whole bunch of people, and the floors were sticky as shit because of the night before.
It definitely is the new punk, and hip hop has been the new punk ever since the 80s because it had moved away from rock. And punk isn't a type of music, it's an aesthetic, it's an energy, it's an attitude. Everything's kind of being homogenized to be rooted in current trap trends, you know? But then we have what Peep was doing kind of interlaced between this new trap, melodic trap.
Apparently I got a Wikipedia page. I was looking at my Wikipedia page. The genres was like alternative rock, like R&B, hip hop, trap, emo, pop punk. So they don't really know what to call it, you know what I mean?
People don't realize actually how hard it is to take an established style of music or styles of music and combine them together and make them be something new. And that's what the greatest stars of the world did. You know, you could talk about Prince, for example, and if he's taking from the Beatles and Jimi Hendrix and Parliament and Funkadelic and others and mixing it together and it becomes Prince. It's like, Little Peep was a guy who was fascinating to me because he was basically doing the same thing. If he was taking Green Day and My Chemical Romance and his favorite trap and hip hop music and marrying those styles to create something new, you gotta kind of be a genius to be able to do that kind of stuff and make it work, and he was.
I mean, I've met people I've thought were amazing, and I've had instincts where I'm like, you're a star, this. But this was like something much more, much deeper. And I knew that at the time.
Peep was becoming the new guard of the LA underground scene. It was so clear that he was going to be, you know, the guy on top.
Eventually, we Josh Binder and a guy from my office made an agreement with him.
Go meet with Sarah, and Sarah and I hit it off. She's an amazing person, and she's like, look, I want to bring you in. I want to partner with Peep, and I want to bring you in as manager. When he told us about GBC, it's like, that's great, but we're focused on you. And that's kind of, there was also tension between GBC and myself because my priority was Gus. When he moved, everybody gravitated towards his place. And his place, people would say all the time, this is the new loft. 20% of the time, he might've used his bed. It was like always, like I'd go in like Tracy, Khan, Horsehead. Everybody was like, I'd go into his room looking for him. And I was like, who the fuck is this? Like, it's just some random dude.
He called me like the next day, like, yo, put another sample over that and find another D-Day's Grace song. And I was like, really? Okay. And I did it. I found a cool one and then I brought it to him. I was in a room laying on the like futon, a little futon I had in there like this, and they're recording. I'm like sick, having anxiety attack because I've been up so long and like we're just doing too much. I'm like thinking in my head, like, I'm going so hard, making so many beats. And all of a sudden I hear, Switchblades!
Cocaine!
I'm like, yo, what the fuck?
Cocaine all night long. When I die, bury me with all my ice on. When I die, bury me with all my ice on. When I die, bury me with all the lights on. Lights on! Night life!
way, but I was like, damn, this white dude go hard, you know what I'm saying? So I started doing research on him. I was like, where is he from? You know, just trying to find out some shit about him, man, you know what I'm saying? I was just happy to see that somebody actually stepped up to the plate and was like, fuck it, I'm gonna do my shit like this.
Okay, cowboy claim an ocean. Black gold, got boy click in a bad mode. Switchblade, cocaine, got boy quick to my soul's head. Black jeans, have black gloves, got boy click in a castle.
Now you gotta get a picture doing the same picture next to this.
I'm saying, I like this. Yo, American Reject, yo, hate to look.
You think a lot of people used to doubt you?
I used to doubt myself, and now I don't anymore.
Dude, I don't think anybody realized, like, what was happening while it was happening, you know? And that's why, like, now I try to put the timeline on everything that happened, and this shit is a blur to me.
All those experiences, dude, you know what I'm saying?
That 2,500 was the first show.
Watching him sell out 3,000 people in Russia with no radio record ever, never being there before. 3,000 kids singing every single fucking word. Headliner, no support, none of that shit, like, insane.
Sold out London, sold out Belgium, sold out Russia, sold out Berlin, sold out your mom.
I get on the stage and rap till I pass out. Hit another city, I'm just grooving. I was trying to tell you I was losing. I was gonna tell you I'm improving. I done caught a vibe, she was choosing. Gotta keep my pride, I'm a general. Gotta keep it real with some criminals. Gotta keep my focus up for
nothing. We get off the plane and totally did not expect there's just like hundreds of fans waiting for him. I don't know how they knew what flight, I don't know how they knew where to find us, but they were there with signs and gifts, and there was crying and there was screaming, and I was like, Chase, is this normal? Like, is this gonna happen a lot? And like, he's like, yeah, probably. And to be honest, it did. Everywhere we went in Russia, it became a spectacle.
Stacks hit us out the mattress. Racks hit us out the mattress. Packs hit us out the mattress. Gangs hit us out the mattress. Burp dipping through traffic. I'm getting better, I'm in practice. I'm working every day crafting. I'm cool on her, how them had her. Bounce back with a million. Hit her out of like Gilligan. Not just a regular civilian. I rap on the squad, I'm a champion. Remember we hit up the Howard, we got us a stash spot.
Faraon.
We stayed here for 10 hours. With 10 hours we stayed here. We love you very much here.
This music and my friend's side, and I really enjoyed it. It's really interesting, and I don't know. When I listen to this music, I'm really enjoyed. I want to paint, I want to do something, and it's really cool. His music is really cool.
It was funny because like kids from Kazakhstan and like territories that like I would have never imagined came really far away to come to that show. And like that was really like kind of eye-opening to me that he was more than just like a guy that's big in Russia, like, you know what I mean? Like when kids are taking these long ass bus rides to come in and see this show, I think that speaks volumes of like where he was already at that point of his career.
He's the biggest fan. He's the biggest fan.
Hey, yeah. How's the people doing?
You guys coming to the show?
Yes, club.
If you got any friends that need to get in, then put them on the guest list too.
We don't have any friends in
here. No. I'm so far away, right?
You guys are what?
Hmm? Yeah, we're all brothers.
Brothers?
Yes.
All brothers?
Yes.
Oh,
shit. You guys fight a lot?
Yeah.
Yes.
Sometimes.
Quite a bit.
Sometimes. They're fighting.
Yeah.
We have to share a room together. So it's getting hard sometimes.
That's great. Yeah, I have a brother 2 years older than me.
Yeah, pretty.
Yeah, we fight a lot.
You're excited for the show tonight?
Yeah, I am.
Hey, so we're gonna go to the club and drop the stuff off, and then go from the club. The venue's really close to the club. So we can drop all the stuff, do a quick check.
I see your face when I look out the window. Yeah.
I put some cocaine in my already bleeding nostril.
Do you have to shit?
Yeah, this coke's gonna make me
You're gonna have to deuce, man.
It's gonna be a shit show tonight.
That fucking Indian food's already bleeding out of me, dude.
Indian food and cocaine? Shit fast?
Curry! Cocaine!
Curry!
Cigarettes make you shit, dude. You should smoke a whole
My time. Hair is dead as fuck, bro. It's fucking dead.
It feels so fucked.
It is. It's like strong.
It's gonna all fall out.
Dude, it is falling out.
Maybe you should just condition it once.
Switch.
I blades. Do. I do.
And oh shit.
He believed in equality. In a way, I think that he maybe struggled with the idea that all things aren't equal, that you, even just with the concept that you have to rise above, means you're, all things aren't equal. You can't be equal with your friends. That's why he'd give away a lot of things and allow people to share, to live in his house and allow people to share all his stuff and give away his money. Because he believed in that concept.
He was anxious about not being able to be enough for everyone and that everybody just wanted so much from him. This apartment is because of him. He paid my rent in August and I didn't ask, but he knew my money was bad and it was the day he bought that triple pendant diamond chain.
Everyone was experiencing it for the first time. They didn't understand how anything worked. They just, they thought that Peep had this endless supply of money and he has this credit card and he can use it whenever. And I don't think Peep understood how it worked either. Like, I don't think Peep was conscious of the fact that what he's spending, he had to make back, you know? But like, no one was, because everyone was learning for the first time. Everyone was so young. And like, this is not a good situation of all these kids being dependent on him like this. Like, this is gonna end up bad.
This is the grandson of someone that was part of leftist causes around the fucking world. his grandfather fucking has the Medal of fucking Freedom from the fucking the Mexico City Workers Union. Like, he went there and became one of them, and it's almost kind of like what Pete did. He came here and became one of the kids.
He had very big plans. You know, he said he wanted to take capitalism out of the music industry. Not just revolutionize music as it sounds, but revolutionize, make a revolution, like change the structure of the power structure of who was controlling it. He was so excited by that. But I do think that he was kind of wrestling with the materialism of the entertainment business, I guess you could call it. He came home in August, you know, saying, oh, you know, and capitalism, and it's just awful. And look at how they make these decisions about me and the way I look, and it's just all wrong. And I just, you know, I gotta be, these are my bros and my brothers, and I just wanna just make music, and we all help each other, and it's a collective, mama. It kind of was tied to, you know, a sense of justice that he has.
The guilt of being, having more charisma, more talent, more, you know, everything.
Dear Gus, believe me, I know things about boys your mother cannot know. She's learned it now from Oscar and you. But I already know it, having lived through it and learned it from Alfred. I can tell you, I see pure gold in you. It's not just success. Actually, it's not success at all. It's the good we do, the good you can do, the good I believe you will do, the good you don't understand now, can't see now, but will see better and better as you get older. There's tremendous strength in this kind of work, the kind that moves mountains. It's a strength that comes purely from a deep, special kind of yearning, a yearning for making things right, a yearning for justice. I'm sorry about your bite being stolen. Let's just say, without planning to do it, we gave it for Christmas to a poor kid. But while I'm in this world, you're not going to go without a real Christmas present, even if it's not the same kind of little bike we'll get you some wheels. Only remember, the best presents aren't things, material things, but qualities, experiences we cannot lose. You, your mom, and Oscar and Alfred coming to see me at Christmas was by far the best present I could have. I can't lose it. It's in a better place even than my memory. It's in the memory of my heart. Is there any particular Johnny Cash CD you'd like? I hope you stay warm and well, study hard, be good. Hasta Febrero. Love, your Grandpa Packack.
I think there were two people. It was Gus and there was Lil Peep. And I think a lot of us have that kind of duality, but with him, it happened to have a name. And I think he would, his nature, he, one side, he would be the kid who was like, I want a sanctuary. I don't want a party. I want to hang out and just be chill. And who was completely sweet and, you know, just like an amazing human being. And then you have this other person that's way more flamboyant, way more reckless. It was like this daredevil that he would go harder than anybody else. Everyone was doing blow or pills. He was going to out-blow everybody. He was just, he went hard.
The fam is back. The fam is back. Money comes and you can see, baby. We have a voice. Dude, once you become successful, I mean, no matter like what field it's in, but I mean, especially music, it's what do you want and how much of it do you want? Because I can have it here right now. And if you are the star of the party, all anybody wants to do is give you what you want. You can have as much of whatever. You know, you like girls, here you go. You like blow, here you go. You like alcohol, here you go.
Everyone wanted to feed him drugs and, you know, they wanted him to like him and, you know, like, oh, like you're gonna feel so good, whatever. I saw people offering him drugs all day and night.
But like it would slow down, and that's why it would be difficult, because like I would tell Chase, okay, yeah, he does drugs. But then Chase would come and be like, okay, yeah, like you have a problem, like you're an addict, you're this, you're that, like Layla's telling me that you're doing drugs, and he's like, okay, well, I can stop, I don't have to do drugs. And then like a week would go by and he wouldn't do drugs, like he really could stop and he wouldn't do them, but like when he did do them, it would sometimes would be excessive.
Then we finished the tour, the last few dates in Seattle. Then there was like a day or two off, and then there was the end LA show.
Watch out, vehicle stopped on shoulder ahead.
He had been touring around the country and the world, and I was excited to finally see him in Los Angeles after, you know, his rise as a young independent artist. And I think I got to the show maybe a half an hour before he was supposed to go on, and Chase comes over to me, and he said, I was thinking about canceling the show. And I said, why? And he goes, because you know, I think Pete might have taken a little too much of something. And I was like, that's not good. And all of a sudden, everybody kind of empties the backstage, and I think there's about 5 minutes before showtime. Chase runs and you know, tries to get the stage ready, and we're in the stairwell, and it's just Peep and I. And Peep looks at me, he goes, I don't know if I can do this. And I was like, okay. And some guy opens the door, and he goes, it's time. I go, all right, and look at Peep, and I'm fearful that he won't be able to find the stage because he's disoriented. He runs on stage. He's able to stand.
There was a lot of talk about what was going to happen if he wasn't able to perform. There was talks of even calling him to, like, not make the show cancellation be on his back, but, like, calling the fire department and reporting the venue over capacity and having the city come and shut the show down instead of it being canceled on our end.
He keeps on telling me, Pete, leave it alone. I'm good on my own.
There was a point where he like disassociated with like the show. And I start hitting the fog machine, like just like flood the stage with fog. And like Tessa was next to me and she had like a trash can in case he needed to puke. It worried me, you know, like I was like, yo, like the one day you're like out of my sight, it's like things went really bad. And like, I don't know what was about to happen when he hit that weird dazed moment. It was really weird. It was very unlike him. I don't know what happened, and he snapped right back into it.
He found it. He like found his way. He mumbled through the first song and got the chorus, and at a moment it clicked. Killed the entire show. After the show, all the record people are just blown away, thinking like, this is the guy. I go upstairs to say hello to him. He goes, I told you I could do it. And at that moment, I was like, we got a problem.
I'm sorry, man. You know me.
He was kind of nodding off something and putting some ecstasy in his mouth to get on stage. And, you know, Chase was sort of like, get that shit out of your mouth, like hands down his throat, like trying to literally fish the pill out of his mouth. You know, and there's this sort of realization where Pete just sort of grabbed the pill and just ran into the bathroom and locked the door behind him. And it was just a heavy moment where it's this sort of, you're not my dad. Or this sort of, you can't control me. He divulged a lot of like very intimate, very personal things. And just feel like he had a crazy life. And I think what it told me was just like, it's someone who almost went through some sort of like ego death or something. Like he felt like he like transcended his own ego, or the battle that someone would have with their own ego and acknowledging their own pride and sort of all these things. It just seemed like something had crushed that a long time ago.
Did he ever talk to you about his dad?
Little bit. It's pretty vague and pretty, not really. He didn't really, he did mention that he would tell me more down the road.
When I was a young peep, my father took me into the city to see a baseball game. He said, son, when you grow up, I'll leave you, and then you'll make a lot of money in like 2 years.
He was the coach dad, so he coached them. And that was really his relationship with them, was to be their coach. I mean, I think if you ask a lot of people, they'll say, yeah, he never talked about his dad. You know, I think he was ashamed of him. I think he may have been ashamed of the way his father treated him.
Johann had so little respect for Gus that he actually would talk to his girlfriend on the phone in the car when Gus was in the back seat. And finally one day Gus went upstairs and told his mother.
Obviously, I've never stopped thinking about what it took for him to do that. He's like 12 or 13 years old and standing there in front of his father, calling his father out to me. And at that moment, from that moment on, you can imagine his relationship with his father.
Oscar, do you know where this tree could go? Oscar, he gets good shape.
Dear Gus, after the letter I sent you yesterday, I need to write you something else, because it's been pressing me so sharp and hard on my mind the last couple of days. You all three, your brother, you, and your mother, have been now through two very stressful years, the collapse and end of her marriage, and the collapse and end of the only family your brother and you ever knew. This has to be terribly painful and confusing. Off and on, it makes people frantic, bewildered, and furious. It's probably something you cannot talk about with anybody. But my advice is, if you can't talk about it, at least don't deny it or run from it. Ask yourself whom you respect, if anybody, and if there are any such people, write a few words, maybe no more than a short sentence or two, saying to yourself why you respect them. And if you don't respect anything or anybody, including me, ask yourself why you don't. Maybe you have good reasons. Maybe you don't. Maybe you don't think you need a reason. Just think about it, not once, but over days. One day you and I might talk about it. Love. Your Grandpa Packer.
We didn't talk about it for a long time. He just told me he hated his dad. Doesn't really know him like as a person. And one day, he mentioned something about how it fueled a lot of his lyrics. It was bad. It definitely scarred people in a way that, like, I think nobody knew about.
That's what I'm telling you, bro. There was some pain in this kid. And I saw it from the beginning. And there's more to that story that, like, that is not my place to speak on. And God knows whose place it is to speak on. It might not be anybody's place to speak on.
I would always tell people, like, he is not lying. He's not making things up. These songs are his true feelings, and this is real. good or bad, this is all the truth.
Obviously, you hear it in his music. It's very, very apparent in the lyrics that he was unhappy, right? But spending time around him day to day, that wasn't what he gave off. He came off as very, you know, charismatic and alive and, like, happy.
Gentle, lighthearted, and honestly, good-spirited all the time. Like, I just felt good energy around him all the time. He was never a miser or a negative person. Just like light, like fucking just like goofy as hell. Like, just funny, always joking. Like making a joke out of everything.
Today, we all hit Rodeo Drive. You know, cash the fuck out, some Louis Vuitton, some Birkin bag.
10 years ago. Been on my own since age 9. 16 lines of blow and I'm fine. Break my bones, but act as my
friend.
Chicken breast and coleslaw.
Yeah, pizza base, nothing on it.
I can get a pizza base.
What are you getting? Creamy fruit salad.
I can get blended. Oh my god, the coleslaw is blended with creamy mayonnaise.
He was looking out for a hella people, like, he looked out for, like, everyone. Like, I felt like he was going kind of crazy. It just seemed like he was losing his mind for a little bit. He just kind of realized, like, he needs to just do him, and he did.
He seemed uncomfortable in his own house.
Like, on edge.
I mean, no seats, there's all these people. He's standing in the kitchen. Yeah. There's everyone sitting on the sofa.
It was like he didn't want us to see him that way.
Yeah.
He's written lyrics about it, like, you're in a room full of people, but you're alone.
If people wanted to hang out, even if he was tired, he would never say no. He would never, there were times where he'd be like, I don't want these people in my place. But he wouldn't tell them to leave. I don't know, like saying no to somebody to him was like hurting them. And he didn't want to do it.
He told me he used to like cry in his wardrobe and shit because he didn't even have a bed. People are in his bed, his sofa. Yeah. He'd sit
there and
cry, try not to cry too loud, like he would say. He's in his wardrobe crying just on his own, you know?
Fuck this nigga, he don't want to come to the studio with us, man.
Yeah, I do,
bro. Fuck this nigga, man. He don't want to come to the fucking studio with us. Oh yeah? You don't want to come to the studio with us, huh?
But that's when I was like, you have to get out of LA. I realized it was unmanageable with all these people. And I said, you have to get out of LA.
I remember like Dre or Goth, one of them called me and they were crying. And they were like, oh my God, like, what are we gonna do? Like, Gus is going to London. And I was like, what do you mean? They're like, he's moving. Like, we all just like went to his house and like, he told us he's moving to London. And I'm like, when is he moving? And they're like, tomorrow. And I was like, oh, fuck no. Like, you're lying. Like, there's no way he's moving to London, like, in one day.
Can't afford to fall in love with you. Not today, girl. It's a life, it's a movie. No, no, baby, mine is a future.
Tilt your hands down a little more. Yeah, that's it. And eyes the camera.
I mean, if you saw like his course of action, it's just, it's kind of crazy. He just had so many things coming out at all times and so many things around the corner. And he'd truly gotten into a flow where he was just rolling forward with so much. Fashion was honestly like the next big thing. He wanted to start his own clothing brand, No Smoking. He thought to himself, I could design the coolest shit.
And I was like, he's going to Fashion Week. I want him to arrive like a star. I said, I want him to roll into Fashion Week. And I was like, he's gonna be a really big star. And he actually was. Everyone went crazy for him.
There was something very innocent and childlike in his lack of understanding at the beginning of the fashion industry, of designers, of photographers, of stylists. He didn't really understand why this was all happening and why there was such an interest in him. Somebody doing their first fashion shoot with Mario Testino for V magazine, being styled by Nicola Formichetti, a really like a stylist who's kind of responsible for the careers of like Lady Gaga, who at the time was the creative director for Diesel. It was a huge deal. And so that would give him like that springboard into fashion industry.
How is this fashion? This is ridiculous.
First time in Paris, mate.
Fucking die. I'ma be too fly. See me looking like a goddamn.
If, can we get a bounce down of that?
That
and can you send it back to that email that I sent?
McConan looked at it like this. I like this kid. He's cool as fuck. Let's do this shit. And let's go hard. They were FaceTiming me from that fucking studio constantly. Like, I was supposed to be there as well. It's just that I never liked inserting myself into these situations. I wanted them to, like, fucking have creative freedom in their moments. Like, what the fuck am I gonna offer the situation? Like, I'm not fucking here, fucking.
It was very surreal. And I felt with him, I was like, you look like me on the outside. You know what I'm saying? Like on the outside with all your teeth, that how it's just like, rawr, it's scary. I was like, that's how I really am on the inside. And I said, but you on the inside look kind of soft and nice as how I look on the outside. And you know what I'm saying? So we were just, we would have this cool little, you know what I'm saying, dynamic with each other to where it's like, we're saying we're little brokenhearted teddy bears and we're like repairing each other. You know, me and him. And so like, you know, we're making this music, right? And so like this music was like, it's gonna heal the world and it's gonna elevate us into pop star land.
Hello.
It was great, man. I've never made music like that with anybody. Like, it's just, it was never a dull session. You know what I'm saying? The only time we had to leave the session is because too many people came to the session. And I'm like, we've got to get out of here. Like, it's just getting hectic. We're not getting our work done. And then, like, people, we're so nice, right? He's so, I started having to try to teach him, like, bro, and they're going to take everything. You have to start being like, no, no, no.
And me and McConey kind of like fucking towards the end, I'll be honest with you, like, we weren't being dicks. We weren't being haters to like his whole group of friends. Like, you know what I mean? But like, did me and McConey tell him specifically needed to stop fucking hanging out with everybody he was hanging out with and kind of take a step back and let this like fucking wave get to where it was going? Cause I already saw where it was.
I would be with him sometimes and some of his friends would call him and be like, what the fuck? Like, I'm going on tour. I'm doing this. Like, we're coming. Sometimes he would really cry and be like, I don't know how to help them. I've done everything. Like, they're all homeless. I let them stay at my house. I let them come in and out. I let them wear my clothes. I buy them food.
When we went to London, sort of him and GBC were kind of having some sort of riff or something, and they were kind of saying like a lot of negative things, and he was feeling sad and stuff and about it. And I was like, a lot of people don't want you to grow without them. You have a lot of great opportunity going on. Your music is so real, and I know that you've been in your pain and hurt to get this music. And this is like, when you do this, you're alone, right? And all you really wanted is others around you. And now you have everybody coming around you for all the wrong reasons. Your friends are gonna start saying the worst things about you. You know what I'm saying? The ones that you were with the longest and you were friends, and then they're gonna start saying the worst things about you and it's gonna hurt you the most.
I distinctly said to him, you know, you're not just a rapper. And he said, yeah. And I said, you do know that in order to achieve what you're gonna be able of achieving, you're gonna have to leave people behind. And I said, do you understand that? And he said, yeah. He said, I know that.
Hello.
Chase reached out and was like, you ready for the next one? I was like, okay, you know, okay. Because now at least I knew a little more of what to expect and I was coming in a little bit more prepared. So that was nice. But it didn't matter, you know, like it didn't matter in the end because like so many things got changed the week before that tour left.
This is him leaving officially. Fishnock and yours is kidnapping. They are responsible. They are responsible. This is him right now. This is the before video in case this goes tits up.
The tour was originally supposed to be just him, and I think he wanted to bring Tracy.
You know, that was his original plans until everything went down like a week before tour. He didn't want to tell them I'm leaving GBC without kind of giving them a present, you know, taking them on tour and getting them exposure.
It was like this perfect storm. It's like that was happening while he and I had an issue and he was touring where I couldn't be close to him. And, you know, and so that led to the situation of having to switch tour crew, and we had a whole new crew. And we had like days to do this. We had maybe like 3 to 5 days.
The people brought in had no fucking idea what they're doing. The LD was holding it down. He was pretty much being production manager and tour manager, and that's not his fucking job, you know what I mean? But he was like, this is a nightmare. This is the worst tour I've ever been on.
What I do, how old I am, where I'm from?
Your name, how old are you, where you're from, what you do.
Okay. My name is Lil Pete, I'm 21. I'm from Long Island, New York. I'm a goth boy, I'm a Lego boy.
When did you notice goth boy quick started to pop off?
I noticed goth boy quick started to pop off when I had to start walking around with my shades on, you feel me?
What's it feel like to see kids lying down the block to see you?
It feels like I gotta keep my shades on.
You gotta answer it differently.
Okay.
So the feeling I get from seeing kids lying down the block?
The feeling I get from seeing kids lying down the block for my show is that I gotta keep my shades on.
How does it feel to have kids sing your lyrics back at you?
When kids sing my lyrics back at me, it reminds me that I need to keep my shades on at all times.
How has this tour been?
This tour has been great. My shades have been on the whole time.
I'm kissing styrofoam. Who know it? I'll be on. That's what I'll be on. She know it, I'll be on. Who know it, I'll be on. That's what I'll be on. Baby, move along. I keep moving on. I keep moving on. We keep making up. I keep moving on. We keep making up. I keep moving on. We keep making up. I can't make it up. Somebody wake me up. Yeah. Pour it up with my whole team. Madness swerving a white beam. Yeah. God boy clear, tryna stay clean. Yeah. God boy clear, we got big dreams. And my new bitch on a movie screen.
You're open through your lyrics and through your music in terms of the of your relationship with anxiety. And of course, the byproducts of things like that, like depression and such. And this is a very important subject now because more than ever, we're seeing, you know, kids and young people really suffering through this. This is now an established part of life. You know, how is your relationship with that right now? Now you're actually out on the road, keeping yourself busy, touring, making music. Is it still a struggle for you to stay centered and stay, you know?
Yeah, definitely, man. If anything, things have gotten worse, probably.
Because of the traveling and the touring and the pressure?
Yeah, things just get worse. The anxiety just gets worse and worse and worse every day.
Every time I saw him, he would cry to me. Like, every time, how much he, like, wished, like, everything could go back to normal and he didn't have this pressure on him and he wished we could just be in his room and, like, do nothing all day like we used to, but, like, it just, like, can't happen anymore.
I have a salmon avocado roll, a tuna avocado roll, an avocado roll, please, extra soy sauce. Can I have your sauce, please?
By the time we get to, like, El Paso or like those later dates, me and that kid have been up every night for hours. My sleep schedule is stupid. Like, I don't know, I was kind of going insane for 2 months, you know, for 2 months we were like nonstop. He was going so hard for everyone else.
for the past 2 months. I haven't seen a friend's face.
Friends, business, management. He had a lot of pressure on him, you know? Like, he was just a one human being. And I think under anybody would have a problem with dealing with all of that. And it came from every angle, you know what I mean? It really did come from every angle. He had a lot of kindness. He had a very warm heart, cared about anybody. Like, you know, like, and like, I think people like were like, oh, because he's so kind, I can like probably get his time, or I can probably get him to do this or that, or like give me a feature, or listen to my problems. And like, he didn't have all the answers for his own problems. Like, how is he supposed to help all these people? I mean, his music was like the most he could give them, I feel like, and people wanted almost more. He couldn't be everything to everyone, you know what I mean?
Wednesday, November 15, 2017, 20, 52, and 48 seconds.
Hello?
911, what is the emergency?
I need an ambulance.
Okay, what's the address?
I'm at The Rock. I'm at a venue called The Rock.
All right, tell me what's going on there.
I work with an artist and he's just completely out of it. He's cold, he's just knocked out. I don't know what he's facing,
okay.
But he's completely out.
Awake?
He's not awake. We're trying to wake him up and he's
all
not
right.
awake at
Is
all.
Is he breathing normally?
Not really, no.
All right. We're getting the help set in now. I want you to get him flat on his back on the floor with nothing under his head.
I'm on the phone to the ambulance now. Bro.
Okay, are you next to him now?
We're in the bus.
Okay, can you get him just flat on the ground?
We need to get him flat on the ground.
If he is not breathing normally, we need to start CPR to keep the oxygen pumping through his blood.
We need to get him flat on his back. We need to get him flat on his back.
CPR now. If he is not
breathing normally, we need to get him flat on his back.
We need to get him doing CPR.
On the floor. On the floor, yeah, on the floor.
If whoever's doing it starts to get tired, have somebody else take over.
If she gets tired, then fucking take over. But they stay on the phone. Okay. Is somebody on their way?
They're already on their way. Lights and sirens.
They're on their way.
Right there. They're not very far away.
Fucking hell.
You don't know how to call a mother to tell her that her son just died. So I called her and she had like woken up. I think she said she had just gone to sleep and I was just like, Liza, I'm so sorry. Peep has passed. We think he OD'd, but the paramedics were there and the cops, you know, declared him dead. What kept going through my head is like, I have, you know, two babies and I'm just like putting myself in his mother's shoes and I'm trying to process that this kid who I've spent the last year and a half taking care of is gone and
I looked at him like he's so strong to me. And then he looks at me like I'm so strong to him. So it was just, you know, it's a great, it's like, it makes you feel worth it. You know, especially when you look up to somebody. And you look up to somebody and they look up to you back. And so where you guys are feeling equal. And it's not like you're looking up to somebody, anything, you just feel. You just for to feel good being accepted by another. And so that's what me and Lil Peep had.
The reality is that Peep is like a fucking Viking and that he probably could muscle the unimaginable. However, he took, you know, over the lethal dose of fentanyl I mean, there's no fucking, that's just death. That's like death for anyone who takes it, you know? He got spiked with something that like was far more than any system could take, you know? It was sort of, he just got fucking killed, you know?
I remember seeing one video as a kid in the beginning, it was daylight still. He was passed out. And then the second video with Bexy, it was already dark and he already looked like he was fucking gone.
At least hours, like 4 or 5 hours go by. And there's obviously timestamps for this too. So there's like proof that like 4 or 5 hours go by and the sun's down and he's in the exact same position. Like no one decided to touch him, not one person.
Listen, I came onto the bus. My first thing I always do is check on Pete. Went straight to the back of the bus. Everybody's on the bus now at the front. Opened the door, seen him, blanket, like light off first of all. Aircon blowing, which is something he does when he goes to sleep, yeah. He's covered in a blanket and his head's back looking like he's knocked out. I was under the belief, yeah, that Pete went to sleep.
So how the fuck is there any type of motive or any reasoning behind some type of conspiracy? I can't even go online, my nigga. Looking at my mom in the eyes, bro, like every little thing that I've ever done wrong just blown up, my nigga. It's the most embarrassing thing, my nigga. And especially when I know the fucking truth, you know? And I know that this shit is just so wrong, my nigga, and just all lies. I'm just so paranoid, like, may not even be y'all doing. I don't know how this may be flipped, you know? What specific parts of this documentary are gonna be pointed against me and my family? You know what I mean?
Well,
it will have nothing to do with you guys. Yeah. It will be completely out of here, bro. You feel me? Yeah. No, I mean, like, after this comes out, you feel me? Certain parts that get picked up, you know what I mean? And edited by the conspiracist and, oh, this is why this happened and this is why the, suck my dick, bitch, nigga. That's why this happened, nigga. You feel me? Fuck you, bitch, nigga. You got me fucked up, nigga. That's why this happened.
Peep's death, it's a lot of mystery behind it. What the fuck was everybody doing? Like, I'm not sitting here pointing no fingers. I wouldn't know, so I don't know. Like, hey, if you need 30 minutes, okay, cool. You need an hour, all right. It's a little weird. But four hours? I don't know, man. I don't know. I don't know about that. I don't know exactly what happened, but to me, something ain't right. I'm telling you right now, keep this in there. Half the people that's gonna be in this documentary, they bullshitting, they cloud chasing. That's all it is. You have to be aware of your surroundings because not everybody your friend. So I believe he was starting to wake up. But he just couldn't because he didn't get the opportunity to. Everything came back full circle.
We're right here. I'll be back in the morning. You know that I'm not that important to you, but to me, girl, it's so much more than gorgeous. So much more than perfect. Right now, I know that I'm not really worth it. If you give me time, I can work on it.
He did not get to have his life. He was going to get to really have an experience.
I think what really is heartbreaking to me, though, is that he had endured a lot of pain and he had fought his way through it. And he was, you know, he'd fought his way through the pain of his childhood, really, but he just didn't give up. But that's why I have anger. That's the thing, you know, so like all of this is like you get holding on to him, and then no one let him go. But you definitely don't want to let him go.
had my usual day, a couple hours at the gym in the morning and then working hard in the afternoon. Come home about 6:30, make my soup, and go to bed. And get up at 5 and do my routine for the next day. And but then some point in the middle of the night, the light went on and Jenny, Liza's mother, came. She has a key to the house. And she came in and kind of just touched me, and with the light, I woke up, and she said, I was kind of taking a breath, "Gus is dead." And that woke me up. I don't think I'd felt anything that bad. Or so strangely bad. Ever before. It's just a wound that I think it heals, but only in the sense that the pain of it never really ends. The shock of the pain subsides unevenly, because sometimes, you know, the littlest thing, Harvard Square, I see some kid walking along the way Gus walked in a kind of, I don't know what kind of, how to describe it. And just, you know, I mean, daily, you, gets to you. You know, everybody's life in that way is some kind of instant in eternity. And the good in it is just there forever. I mean, I think Augustine got that from Plato, and from what he understood from Greekish gospels like John, that these things are limitlessly good, and that makes me feel I don't have to worry about it. It's just true. I mean, there's that gospel song that I remembered some point over the last few years about this little light of mine. But the chorus is wonderful, more than the verses, I think. It's about, do remember me way beyond the blue. I think that's where truth is, way beyond the blue. But it's as real as it is here and now. So Gus is gone, but you know, he's way beyond the blue. The deepest significance of being in the world, but not of it, You don't have to accept the limits of it. And certainly Gus didn't. And he had work to do, and he wanted to do it, to say what he had to say, a real bell-ringing truth. He wanted to get it right and get it out. And I think that's, you know, real art, and more than that, real soul.
Floodlights, we fly every night. Baby, I don't wanna do that. Your tight jeans, tight dirty Sprite. She like, how the fuck you do that? I can't be there all the time, but you know I gotta prove that. I can't leave here anytime soon. I got something to do, yeah.
Away as the door slams.